So today I'm going to show you a method. It's a case of a more general method, family of methods called polynomial method, and it's a very powerful new and old method in mathematics. We will talk about geometric incidences and related stuff, but what is first, let me try to give you a motivation. If I can, yeah. So we will talk about incidences a lot, and we will apply them to various problems. And I just wanted to list some of the new results on that problem, incidence geometry or topological or polynomial method. And it's been there for ages. I mean, the method itself, it's much more than 100 years old. But there was this very surprising result of Zev Dvir, who proved the finite field Kakeya conjecture, which he was just fitting polynomials on lines, which we will do for our application. But that was a wonderful result. Now, polynomial method, often when you see then that works very well over finite fields. And there are reasons for that. So his result is also over finite fields, and in particular, high dimensional finite fields. But we will work with the reals, and we will stay in mostly in 3D or 2D. So then there was a nice problem. I will introduce it in details, the joints problem of Jean Bourgain. His question also originated from the Kakeya problem, but real version of the Kakeya problem. And again, you see that by now it's a one page proof where you can prove a conjecture, which we will see there. And there's distinct distance problem that's much more difficult than the previous one, but that followed the idea, some basic ideas from the joint problem. And that was also done by Larry Good and Matt Scutts. And a more recent result that's fantastic problem and result, the cap set problem. I won't really discuss that one. Good, so that's just, if you are interested about the polynomial method, then these are some basic results you want to review. But also there is a fantastic book of Larry Good, written by Larry. And that's about, the title I think is The Polynomial Method, which you can buy at AMS, but also if you go to his website, then there is a slightly earlier version than the printed version is available. So that goes back to the first applications in number theory and then later on. So let's try to give you a bit of motivation. Let's talk about something that you know already. There was an intro on rigidity, and I'm pretty sure that you learned the basics and all of you know this, but let's just repeat because we have here some points to make. So when you have a framework, for us it's just a planar case now, you have a graph and you embed it to the plane, and wherever you had edges, then you fix that distance, so that distance is the same. So two embeddings actually will represent the same framework if the distances along the edges will stay the same. And now this is new, that two frameworks are congruent, or not new, but I want to emphasize that congruent if there is a rigid motion in R2, so rotation, translation, which moves one into the other. So every pair of points, not only the edges, everything. So then we say that those two frameworks are congruent. And I had it last time, so I push one and the other, and it doesn't want to go up and down. And I use the up and down arrow, then I have, okay, doesn't matter, now it will work. So rigidity, probably you learned rigidity and you have several notions for rigidity. And when do we say that a framework is rigid? But for a second, just for a second, please forget that. I say that one embedding, a particular embedding of a framework is rigid if there is a small neighborhood of all vertices, all joints there, which if you find another realization in this neighborhood of the framework, then there is a rigid motion which moves one to the other. So locally, there is no other movement than the Euclidean movements. So this is the usual definition. The usual definition is that local, that for everywhere you have just a small neighborhood. Okay. Because in general, when you have frameworks, what can I do? I'm just trying to switch from one to another. I will do something else. And I click on next slide and it's not working. I'm terribly sorry, I really don't understand. Let me try to smaller, maybe now, yes. So you still see the full?
Yes, we Adobe? Do.
Adobe? We do.
Yes, looks good.
Now I shrinked it to not full picture because it didn't work, sorry about that. So. And we know that, and probably you learned it, that if there is a rigid framework for some embedding, then every generic embedding will be rigid of that framework. So you don't even have to really deal with the specific embedding. But for us, this will be slightly different, yes? Sorry. Right. It's for some reason it's very slow. So you had Lehmann's condition, and I'm sure that you know that. But here is the problem which we are going to consider here, or we will see the tools to attack this problem. That all embeddings under certain conditions, under certain weak conditions, all embeddings are rigid. That's what we are searching for. So we are searching for conditions that if you have a framework, then it doesn't matter how you embed it, no three on a line, some under some weak conditions, then there is at least a rigid part. Yes? So there are a few cases when such results are known. There are some, this result of Walker and Roth is about some cases of a complete bipartite graph. The complete graph is such as that we know, or you know, right? Right. But what we are looking for now are conditions when, if you have enough edges, that will be the condition, then you have at least a rigid part. And how to prove such results. It's not about generic embedding, it's for any embedding. It can't be really any embedding, because here is the example, which probably you also know. If you have the X and Y axis, and you place your joints of the framework along the two coordinates, and you have a even complete bipartite graph there, then it's not rigid. Then you can slide it along the X and Y axis. And it follows from this very simple observation that if you have just three bars, A, B, C, then that gives you the length of D. It doesn't matter what is their position. And of course, you agree that ABC can be moved without any trouble, but then the future bars will also move with them because they will have, in this special case, the same length, yes? And the complete bipartite graph has many, many edges. So we need some condition, and the condition is what you need there. No three, or well, you can bound instead of three, you can say another number, but not many points are collinear. And I don't understand what's happening here, but usually it goes pretty well. Now it just goes up and down. Right, so here is the theorem. Here is our goal. Well, we won't really go to the details, but we will see how to handle this problem. And this should be a general tool, and I will explain how and where. But what we proved with ORITRAS is that there exists an absolute constant such that if you have enough edges, roughly n to the 3/2, slightly more, and you have an embedding of a realization of this graph as a framework, such that here's the condition, no three joints are collinear, then there exists a subset. We don't know the size. Well, it's at least, we wrote here 6, but it's probably actually somewhere square root of n, but we didn't perform all the countings, which is rigid. So it has a part which is rigid. That's all what we can guarantee. And just by the number of edges, you can't do much because maybe you have a very rigid, like a complete graph part, and then you have some parts which you can't really control. So you can't say that the whole thing, unless you have some other conditions which we don't write. Okay, so is it clear what is the statement? The statement is that if you have enough edges, then there should be at least locally some rigid parts in this embedding. So you remember, rigidity belongs to a particular embedding. But for any embedding where no three are collinear, there will be a rigid part. Okay? So this is the goal, and now we go into the theory and intro to the theory. So that's what we are going to do. We will learn more about incidences, point line incidences, and soon point line incidences in three space. Okay, that's the plan. So let me know if there is any question so far, because that's what we are going to do. No questions. So we are going to use the technique which was used, what I mentioned in the introduction, by Netzkatz and Larry Guth in the proof of average distinct distances. But to reach that point, we need some basics first. Anytime, if you have any questions, then please let me know. Okay, so we are going to represent rigid motions using lines. So that's our goal now. Let's go back, what are the incidences? So incidences, you have incidences between points and lines. We will, till the very end of the talk, we will only work with lines and points, so this will be okay. So in this case, this is the Fano plane, and the number of incidences is 21, just to check. So incidence is the point line pair that the point lives on the line. You can't really have so many incidences in the Euclidean plane because that has a different structure. So if the underlying field is different, then the result is different. And let's see first this theorem. This is the classical theorem of Semedi and Trotter. I mentioned that before. This somehow captures the structure of the two-dimensional Euclidean plane. We will see something to say about the three-dimensional case, but before that, let's use part of the technique which we are going to use here. So it says that if you have P points and L lines, then the number of incidences is not more than what you see here, P to the 2/3 times L to the 2/3, and big O means that some constant times. It's smaller or equal than some constant times what you have here. There's this plus P plus L, but that's just to cover the extreme range when you have much more points than lines. We don't really have to worry about this part now. So, okay, and this has many proofs and extensions. And there is a very elegant short proof. Most of you learn that if you learn Samuel Trotter using the crossing number, using the crossing number is very elegant, but you won't learn much about the structure. And it has no possible extension to higher dimension. Before I go further, I just want to mention very briefly, as what I said before, that you have points and lines, and you think that that's just geometry, but it captures number theoretical properties. Also, so here's a famous open problem of Erdős and Samaradi, that you take the sum set as it defined and the product set, then either the product set or the sum set should be very large, as large as it gets, quadratic almost. And that's Paul Erdős and Endre Samaradi, the same Samaradi who we saw up there. Anyways, I just want to show it very briefly. It's a beautiful application of point line incidences using the Samaradi Trotter bound, because now you just use a Cartesian product, A plus A times A times A, and you define the lines like this. Lij is Ai times X minus A. And if X comes from an element of A plus A, which has the form Ak plus Aj, then Aj will cancel out and you arrive to the product set. So every line like this, for every Aj, you can choose Ak n ways. So you have n points on this line. And then immediately, sorry, I don't know why my... Usually I have the presentation mode, but that didn't work either. So that gives a good bound on the either the sum set or the product set should be large. And this idea works even over finite fields. So this was an illustration that just the simple result of point line incidences leads you to very nice results. But what I want to show now is using we have to use if we want to prove something about point line incidences in three dimensions. So let's see a particular proof, or let's sketch a particular proof of Samaradi-Trotter theorem in the plane using a technique which called polynomial partitioning. So polynomial partitioning is based on the fact that if you have measurable sets on the plane in this case, then you will find a low degree polynomial which will divide the sets into two equal parts. If you learn basic topology, then there is a very basic theorem, the ham sandwich theorem. The ham sandwich, that's in three space. If you have a sandwich with ham and cheese, then you can cut with a plane in a way that on both sides, so in the two sides, you have a same amount of bread and cheese and ham, like in the other one. Anyway, so let's see the statement here. So now you have a finite subset for any R that's a parameter. There exists a polynomial of degree roughly R, such that if you remove this polynomial, then there are R squared components, and each will contain roughly the same amount of points, or not more than the portion what you would think. Now, if you never worked with parameters like this, then think about the following example, very simple example. You have points on the plane, nicely distributed, then you just have an integer grid, right? Say with the R lines here, R lines there. That's if you see them as a polynomial, every line is a linear part. So if you take the product, that would be a degree 2 R polynomial, and there are R squared cells, and typically everywhere you have the number of points divided by R squared. So to see the parameters, the numbers, you can always think about a well-distributed point set and just the grid-like structure. But if the point set is arbitrary, then of course there are many ways to place the point sets when you can't do such a partitioning, but you can always do that with polynomials. So the polynomial partitioning, again, it says that if you have a point set and you have a certain parameter R, which you can choose, then you can find roughly R squared cells, where everywhere you have not more than what you expect points, A over R squared. Maybe many points are on the boundary, but let's ignore that part now. And you can do that with a low degree polynomial. So this is, there is some story, how can you do that? And the important thing is that you can do that in arbitrary dimensions. So in particular in 3D, because we will need this application in three dimensions. Right, so now I remind you that there is this very basic form of Bézout theorem, that if you have a line and a degree D curve, so you have a polynomial and an algebraic curve, fxy equals zero, that will define you a nice xy algebraic curve. And if it has degree D, then a line has no more than D intersection points with this curve, or otherwise this line is completely in this curve, so part of the curve. Right? Otherwise, it has only D intersections. So this is the slightly elevated version of the fact that if you have a polynomial, that would be the one-dimensional version of degree D, then the number of zero points is not more than D. If it's D plus one, then this polynomial is everywhere zero. Now, here and in higher dimensions, so the number of intersection points is not more than D. Also, let me know if I'm too slow or I'm just talking about things you knew already. At any time, please feel free to ask me or to give me any feedback. So, now we have lines, and we want to bound the incidences. So for every line, we want to say that it can't contain too many points in the plane, right? Let's consider the lines which have at least 3D points. These are parameters, we can choose it freely. So let's just deal with lines which have many points. And this many, just to have the right numbers, now is 3D. Okay, now if you have 3D points on a line and it's not part of your polynomial, this line, then it will only intersect D points of the curve. Maybe there are points, maybe not, but the important thing is that you have at least D consecutive point pairs which are in a cell. So you go along the line and you see the first point, second point, maybe an intersection point, another intersection point, then points from the line, then so on, so on. Because there are only D cuts in this line, there will be at least, and you have 3D points, at least D pairs of points which are inside the cell, consecutive pairs. And from here, it will be just a double counting. Namely, what we do is that we have a polynomial partitioning with a degree D curve, and each cell contains the number of points divided by d squared, roughly that many points. And the total number of pairs you can have there is not more than the square of this. And so you add the whole thing together. So if you count the total in-cell pairs for every cell altogether, then this will be just a squared over b squared. Are you with me? So if you go back, if polynomials are not easy to visualize at this point, then just think about this grid thing. When you have d or d half, doesn't matter, orthogonal vertical and horizontal lines everywhere the same. When you see a line has three times d points, then many consecutive pairs will be inside the cells. And in every cell, we count what is the total number of pairs which are inside the cell. And this gives the counting what we, so it is at the end that simple, or I think. So it gives an immediate bound on the number of lines which contain at least 3D points. And you can extend it, and that will be, if you put together the numbers, that will be the Samarini-Trotter theorem as we wanted. But we will need it in higher dimension. So with Territau, we gave a generalization to higher dimensional versions. But for us now, this is not that important. What we need is to deal with incidences in three space. Now, if we did so far, that's okay, because now we will use another trick from another polynomial method. So far, we used the polynomials to have a good partitioning. So it's like a generalization of the ham sandwich, what I said. In general, if you have sets in three space, point sets, you can nicely cut them into even parts. And depending how many sets you have, that depends how many, what is the degree of the polynomial you need. I will show you the counting. This is actually just a slight generalization of something what you learned in a linear algebra class, probably during your undergraduate studies, that what is the degree of the polynomial, which at this point has this value, at that point has that value, so you have some specified values. And then, in order to find a solution, you had to find the polynomial, the coefficients were the unknowns and the substitution for the values. Every value gave you one linear equation, and you had a system of linear equations to solve. And well, in that particular case, it was easy. That was a Wundermann matrix. But this is just a reminder that maybe you can recall that thing. What we are going to do now is slightly different. So this was a really exciting result back then, but what was the problem? That was the problem of Jean-Bourguin, and many of us worked on that. I improved the bound a little, but then here is a sharp result. For them, the joint problem was different than the joint in for us.
Jozsef, can I interrupt very briefly before you go to this problem to just go back to the previous one? For a second, previous slide, sorry.
Right. This yeah. one? No.
Yeah, maybe the one is. Before that. Yeah. Okay, so I think this part is clear, but from this, so you conclude from the number of in-cell point pairs altogether, something about the number of lines incident to at least 3D points. Could you just explain how you go from the last but one sentence to the last sentence?
We had a partitioning that with a degree D polynomial, say.
Okay? Yeah.
And then we had D squared cells.
Yes.
And I count all possible in-cell pairs.
Yep.
And there are A over, yes, A over D squared in each cell, the number of pairs, yes?
Mm-hmm. Number of points, number of points, yeah.
No, the point pairs. So the number of points is A over D squared.
Right.
And now you have A over D squared squared.
Yeah.
That's the number of points. Choose two, but I don't care about the constant.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Okay. So you have that many potential segments of lines. And you know that every line which had at least 3D points had at least three, contributes at least D such segments somewhere in this picture, right?
Mm-hmm.
So you just divide all possible pairs with D, and that gives you the bound. So again, the total possible number of such pairs is A squared over D squared, because it's A over D squared, yeah, times, okay, D squared. So it's A squared over D squared.
Uh-huh.
And every line contributes D. So the number of lines times D, that can't be larger than this thing. And that will be the statement, another form of Samarit-Trotter, to say that the number of D rich lines, the points which contain at least three points.
Okay, so that's the part that was, okay. Mm-hmm.
Not more than the number of points squared over D cubed.
Okay.
So, and maybe at this point, I have to say that maybe we won't say that explicitly, but in three space, we will have an improvement. Under certain conditions, in three space, it's harder to get incidences. And there, just to compare the numbers, there the result will be that the number, under some conditions, the number of D-rich lines is not more than A squared over D to the 4. Right, and you can guess what goes in higher dimension. The exponent of D will increase,
yeah,
in every dimension by 1. Okay, so we have this. This is actually just a simple double counting, but it was absolutely new because you have to use the polynomials. Earlier, we had partitioning using the lines, a random sample from the line. So it gave the same result, but it wasn't that nice. And in particular, it was extended to 3D, which we are going to do now. Okay, so let me go further to this problem. Because here we will find a very, or we will repeat almost the same solution that Larry Good and Matt Scott gave. It's an essential way of using polynomials. So what is the problem here? You have, in this case, in Burgain's question, the joints are not joints like what we had with frameworks. A joint is an incident, is a point of which defined by three non-planar lines. So if you have a point, like here, the intersection, I don't know if you see the color, but red, blue, and green inside of this large grid which we have there. If you have three lines meeting such that it's not planar, so it's not, that wouldn't count. That's a joint. And the simple question is that if you have, for technical reasons, you have n squared lines, but if you wish them n lines, but n squared lines, what is the maximum number of joints you can get? And there is a very simple example. If you take the integer grid in 3D, then you have n squared lines here, n squared lines there, so the n by n by n integer grid. Then you have the lines in the three directions parallel to x, y, and z axis. So you have three times n squared, but roughly n squared lines. And every point is a joint, because for every point you have three different directions going through. And what we are going to prove is that actually that's the truth. I mean, I don't know the constant, but you can't have many more than n cubed. There's a constant that the number of such joints is never more than n cubed. So this is a sharp result. And I will show you what to do, but before I do that, let me just tell you the idea. The idea is that you have a set of lines here. Find a three-dimensional surface which contains all the lines. You can do that. It's a similar thing like, I will show you how to do that, but it's similar like when you had the point fitting for polynomials. So you will find a polynomial of hopefully low degree, which will vanish everywhere on those lines. And then if you have such a surface, you want to find out of all those surfaces, the minimum degree surface with this property that it contains all those lines. Right? But every point where you have a joint, that's a singularity. In a joint, you can't put a nice tangent plane there. But if it's a singularity, then in all points, the gradient is zero, right? So you will find a lower degree polynomial, which will vanish in all the joint points. But if there are many joint points compared to the degree of the surface, then the line through those points has too many. So it will also be part of this smaller degree polynomial, so that leads us to a contradiction. So this is the plan, this is what we are going to do, but again, the idea, maybe the way I told you now is not that simple, but the idea is simple. Find the surface, find the minimum degree surface, but if every point has many joints, those joints are singularities, so there is a lower degree surface which should contain all the lines, and that's a contradiction because we wanted to find a minimum degree. This is the crucial part of the whole Woodcut's method. So be sure that this part we follow, be sure that my explanation makes some sense. Okay, good. So lines on surface. For the given set of lines in three space, let us find the smallest degree algebraic surface which contains all the lines. That's our goal. Now this picture, do you know how many lines are there? Anyone? 27. The reason, let's see, somebody said something. Yes, 27, Oliver knew that. Oliver, do you know why? sorry. I discourage everyone now to say anything because then I ask back. Yes, Clara said also, yes, cubic. So I just checked that some of you did learn algebraic geometry. This is not an easy theorem to prove, that if you have a smooth cubic algebraic surface, E in B cubed, so closed, then it has exactly 27 lines. That's a beautiful theorem. If you can prove it, there are different proofs. I won't talk about it, but if you can prove it, then you really know the basics of algebraic geometry. So this is a test, but we won't use that. What we are going to use is just this fitting stuff, okay? Thanks to Clara and Oliver to give me some feedback. You should learn algebraic geometry. I should learn algebraic geometry. That's not my field. What we are going to do is to find the surface. So what is this algebraic surface? What we are looking for? This is a degree the algebraic surface. If we write it, this is just fxy equals with some coefficients, x to the alpha, y to the alpha, z to the gamma, right? We are in R3 now, and it's just some simple real algebraic geometry, not even that, it's simple real linear algebra, what we are doing. So find the smallest degree. Now, what does it mean that a surface contains a line? So we have a line. It's a lucky situation that we can express it with parameters, with t. Say t is a parameter. And any line Lt, t is a sweeping, it's a one parameter. The first coordinate is t, then u times t plus v. The third coordinate is also a nice linear form. And we know that this line is contained by this this surface, what we have here, this f, x, y, z. If you do the substitution t to x, u plus t plus v to y, and the other for the third coordinate, and then what you have, this is only a polynomial of t, all the coefficients are zero. Yes, that's what you need, because in this, along this line, for any parameter of t, the solution is zero. Okay, so let's do that, or let's just observe that. So what we have here is that we have f, the original general polynomial, three variable polynomial. The coefficients are the variables. We want to find the polynomial, so the unknowns are the coefficients. So there are d plus 3, choose 3 variables. Yes, you can check, but that's of course a possible number of exponents you can have there. So the number of monomials you have, and for every line, if you do the substitution, then you have a linear equation. Yes, that this thing should be zero. Luckily, it's a homogeneous system of linear equations. So we have d times n squared linear equations. And if the number of variables is larger than the number of linear equations, then that's it. There is a non-trivial solution. So if we have such d, if we can set d to satisfy this inequality, then that's it. Then there is a surface. We don't know, we don't want to find this surface, but we know that there exists such a surface, and we know that its degree is not very, very large. We know that we will find a surface with degree not more than 3n. Okay? That's important. So we did find an algebraic surface which has relatively low degree and contains all the lines. Now I need one more assumption, that I just threw away the lines which have very few joints on it. It won't hurt the counting. So what we are going to show now, which have many joints, can't be too large. So here is the statement, a slightly simplified, but it's just a technical difference, proving the whole statement or just this lemma. This is the same. In any arrangement of n squared lines, if every line contributes in at least j joints, then this j should be smaller or equal than 3n. Actually, it's smaller than 3n. And from here, you get the result. Either you iterate the statement, anyways, what it says is that n squared lines can't be such that every line has many joints. And then there is one line which has a few joints, then you throw away and you repeat the sentence if you will, but it's just a statement. Now let's see what's happening there. As I said, let's find the minimum degree algebraic surface, and it's important on the minimum degree. And we will see if J is too large, then we will reach a contradiction. So we will see that J can't be too large. So the minimum degree is D now, and And in every joint, the gradient is zero, yes, because you have three lines which are not smooth. So there's no, that point is not smooth. That's a singularity. So the gradient is zero there. But then this surface, which you get from the gradient, which has a degree less than the previous one, than the original one, contains all the joints, the points. But because D, the degree, is smaller than 3n, and there are at least 3n points from every line in this new surface, therefore this whole line is there, the Bessel theorem. But then we did find a lower degree surface containing those lines. Now, this one is where we are at this point, is just linear algebra, although it's a very smart use of linear algebra, but and Bessel theorem, which is, well, actually, one can say that this is also linear algebra. But this is the statement for joints. And then after a few years later on, Guten Katz managed to do a more general case in three space, not bounding the joints, the number of joints, but bounding the meetings of lines, the meeting points. So I don't ask now three to go in linearly independent, anything, no. But if you consider this problem, then you have in three space, if you really want to bound the number of meeting points, then you have a few problems. First of all, you might have just a plane in three space and the number of intersections is n choose two, if you have n lines, yes? Because any two lines will intersect. This is just one problem. There's another one, it's on the picture. There are those very interesting W-ruled surfaces or regulus, or depending how far you go back in mathematics, you will see those special ruled surface. Ruled means that you can go following a line through the surface. So the surface contains many lines. And doubly ruled means that actually every point of your surface has two lines going through. So let's see. The second one, say, that's the usual construction that you have, say, a drum, or let's see, you have just two circles, two regular angles, and you connect the corresponding vertices, and you rotate it by alpha in this direction, and you also rotate it to the other direction by alpha, and you get this nice shape. So why is it problematic for us now? Because you can't have less than quadratic number of intersection points if you allow such configurations among your sets. So what we are aiming for now, in the previous result, we had that the number of joints was not more than n to the 3 half if you have n lines, or n cubed if you had n squared lines, doesn't matter. We want a similar bound, because this will be the key to prove the distinct distances problem, and this will be the key to apply this technique to frameworks to prove the prove the statement I promised at the beginning with Dorit. So what you have to do is to forbid such configurations, and if you forbid large parts, many lines being coplanar or sitting on a doubly ruled surface, then that's the fantastic thing that you can bound the number of meeting points, crossing points of lines. So that's the result. That's the gate results, incidence bound. This is the theorem of Larry Guth and Matt Scott. Fantastic result. Here we will need a little bit of algebraic geometry, but maybe we won't really go through all the technical details. If you are interested about that, then the paper is readable and there are some explanations of what's going on there. So we have, as before, n squared lines, but now here is the condition. No more than n lines intersect at a single point. Yeah, that's also problematic. If you have too many lines going through the same point, then the number of incidences there is pretty large. You have to avoid that. And no plane or doubly ruled surface contains more than n lines. Then the number of incidences, meeting points of lines, not only meeting points, but counting the meeting points with multiplicity, is at most n cubed times a little. Is it clear what is the statement? So the statement is that in three space, you might have some accidents like the doubly ruled surface or having many points on a plane, but if you don't have that, then you have very few incidences compared to the plane. Right. So in the plane, you had n to the 2/3, n to the 2/3, but okay. Let's not even compare it now. This is much better. Any questions so far? Because now we will go to the proof plan. Not really to the proof plan. Okay. So it was used to prove this famous conjecture. It was just a tool. Now it's much more. This is one of the key tools in many discrete geometry problems. So the statement, the Herdős distinct distances conjecture was that among n points, there are at least n over, and the conjecture is that square root log n distinct pairwise distances. Square root because that's what you get from the integer grid and the Herdős conjecture, that's the best you can have. There is still a little room for improvement here, this log n or square root log n. Now, when we see what to do here, the so-called Elekes-Sharif framework, that's also the key what we are going to use for frameworks. With red, you see two bars, if you want, or but two point pairs which have the same distance. In this case, they are 4, 4. Now, if you have two points or two intervals of the same length, then there is a transformation which will move, a rigid motion, which we move one to the other. And you can find it. So how did we find it? Choose two end vertices. There are two ways to choose the pairs of end vertices. In this case, AA and BB, sorry. And find the center or find the intersection of the halving orthogonals of the two. And about this point, which is denoted E, there is a rotation which moves one to the other. Okay, so you see definitely here you have two circles and you have two intervals. One end point on the small circle, the other on the other. If they are in the same length, then it doesn't matter where they are. There is an angle which will move one rotation, which will move one onto the other. Okay, so far that's true. Now the question is that how to represent this rotation? So the Elekes-Sharif framework, Elekes noted that this is the key. If you can somehow bound the following thing, that how many rotations are there which will move k points into k points. Because sometimes it's not only the pairs, but the same rotation might move more than one pair. And the hard part is actually just to count the pairs, but doesn't matter. It's, two-dimensional picture. What can we do? The lucky break is that Larry Guth and Ned Scott elevated the whole thing into 3D. That was still done by Elekes and Sharir, but they found a very interesting parametrization, which was earlier overlooked, which, so what will be the elevation? Here is this halving line, you see, and here is the other halving line. And they will be three-dimensional lines. Now we see the whole picture from above, which will intersect the plane where the whole story is happening exactly in the middle point. And they will go up. So what we do here is that for every line here, we can add a third coordinate, the three-dimensional coordinate, namely from this point, or from any point, say from E, the height will tell you exactly that this point with this center will represent a rotation with angle which depends on the height. Okay, so let's go to the next one, because that's there I try to illustrate the three-dimensional situation. The letters are different, but that's because of the software. Anyways, so you have AF, this one is the same as BG. Yes, and there are the halving lines which we had, but now in a three-dimensional manner. So there is another coordinate, and accidentally, just for those rotations, well, Terry Tau has a very nice blog to say what is this accident and when can you expect something like that. If you parameterize the angle, this one, this is A, and this is also A. You remember that we need the same angle for the two things. Then if you take the height as cotangent A half, then here you have a line. So let's see, what do we have now? We have for any line in three space, it will, well, any line in three space, if you take any point of it, then its projection to the plane will give you the center of rotation. So every point of the line will represent a rotation in the plane. And the height will give you the angle, and the projection will give you the center. If you do that, then here you have two lines which in this point have an intersection, because they have exactly the same angle and they intersect. If you go back to the previous picture, yes? So you know that there is a rotation which will move this one there, and this will be with center of this halving line and that halving line. So you know that the center will be the same and the angle will be the same, so therefore their height will be the same. So what you have now, for any pairs which have the same length, there is an intersection for the corresponding lines. Okay? And just for a second, going back here, that's exactly what we are going to use for rigidity. Because in a neighborhood, you have the same length, because that was a condition that you have the same length. So you have pairs, and if you see at the end vertices, I mean between the two movements, there are two very short intervals, you can have the same rotation lines like here. And then you just count how many intersections are there, how many meeting points are there of the corresponding lines. Actually, that's why in our theorem with Orit, we also have this exponent. If with n joins, you have at least n to the 3/2 times log something edges, then any embedding will give you a rigid part. For that, you have to understand that the rigid part means that many points will meet in one vertex, but that's another thing. Let's see this proof. So there is no way to say that the same nice proof that we had to follow, what we had for joints. There is no singularity here, but something is happening there. So you have two lines intersecting in three space on a surface, and that's a special point of the surface, because you have two directions where really you have a line inside the surface. Of course, if this, it could be a singularity, but you can count the singularity points using the previous trick, because then you can just bound the singularity points on those, like what we did before. But here we have something special. Now, this is what I said, that a little bit of algebraic geometry, but algebraic geometry more than 100 years ago. So there is something which is polynomial. For every algebraic surface, you can define the Flecknot polynomial. And it goes to Reverend Salmon. There is this Cayley-Salmon theorem that for every polynomial, there exists the Flecknot polynomial, which is not much larger degree. It's very close in degree. It's 11 times d, which vanishes in every point where you have an intersection of two points. So you can make it more precise here, but that's the important thing. For every point which is an intersection point of two lines, you do the same thing, yes? You find the surface which contains all the lines. But now you somehow want to count the possible number. So the Flecknot polynomial vanishes at all points of the zero set of P, and the zero set is ruled. So then you have two points. And then now you have two polynomials meeting nicely, and you can use some technical tricks, which I'm not going to explain now, to get a similar situation that we had before with the joints. And right, and this is the point where I stop. It's an hour now. And the next one would be an illustration how to use this technique. But what I told you is this proof of this incidence bound. And I think that we agree that now intersection of lines which are defined by line segments and the specific rotations through the halving points, I mean, the angle that, so intersection points in three space that really can count the number of equal length pairs of points in the plane. Right, so I think that's it. That was 1 hour, a little more.
Yeah, that sounds good. So, you know, I have some questions about the general applicability of the polynomial method and connections to other problems that relate to low degree polynomials and what they're able to interpolate or I have some questions in short. So it'll be nice if we can do the second session, if not for an entire hour, at least for a few minutes. So
well, maybe I can answer all the questions, but I don't know. I don't think that we need the or it's up to you. Of course, you are the organizer. What I show you.
Yes, I was just going to suggest that we take a very short break now, mm-hmm. if we wanted to come back for questions. Unless people have some quick questions right now about what he talked about already, and then we can break for 10 minutes or so and then come back.
It's up to you. So let me tell you that, yes, I can definitely answer questions. And actually, it's related to your question already. I wanted to show you another example of how to apply the simpler polynomial method what we had for joints.
Yeah.
A different problem. And yeah. That's just an illustration just to have a better understanding how this method works. And actually, that was my plan for today. So I didn't go through, and I didn't plan to go through the technical details, my theorem with Orit. You see that there is a connection. The important thing here was to understand the basic techniques for this proof, so the geometry behind. And
so maybe you can say briefly what you plan to do tomorrow.
It also depends on you, I mean the audience. I was planning to talk about still the triples, which was the original
plan. Okay.